All right. Let's see here. When we're done with this, shoot me an email, and I'll add 2.4 points to your independent work for showing up. Same for anybody who's watching the video. I'm not going to force you to answer any questions for this because this is going to help you study for the exam. So if you don't feel like watching it, that's up to you. But anyway, Cooper, go ahead and shoot. I'm ready. Ready when you are.
Okay, so active transport is diffusion against something's concentration gradient with energy. The cell has to put in energy to do that, right?
Yeah, so if it's active transport, like you said, the whole active thing, that should be the hint to remind everybody. If it's active, that means it requires an input of energy. And because it does require an input of energy, hopefully that'll help anybody remember that it's going against the concentration gradient, because diffusion, it doesn't require an input of energy because things just naturally go down the concentration gradient. So yes.
So passive is just diffuse, like normal diffusion with a transport protein. Passive transport.
Let me see. I'm gonna try something new. I'm gonna try the whiteboard. Maybe it'll record.
But it's still going. It's going with its concentration gradient. It just has to get through that transport protein, right?
The first part of what you're saying is true. Yes. Okay. Let's see. Share with one person. You're gonna be able to see this. We'll see if everyone else sees it on the video. This will be new for me. Let me present my screen here. All right. So anyway, come on. Where are we at? There we go. Can you see my little whiteboard?
Yes.
Okay. The best way to think about it is this. This is going to be sloppy, but hopefully this will help. If we're talking about passive transport, I'm going to abbreviate just because it really is hard to write like this. PT, passive transport. I'm sorry. You did say passive transport, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So there's two basic terms. The first one that you asked about, which is active transport and passive transport, right?
Right.
And we just discussed active transport. There's not much to say about that other than it requires energy. Things go down or up their concentration gradient, and it requires transport proteins. Now, passive transport is a more broad term because under passive transport, we have diffusion. That's a subcategory of passive transport.
Okay.
And then under diffusion, we also have the subcategory of facilitated, I'm going to abbreviate again, facilitated diffusion. And facilitated diffusion is the type of diffusion that requires a transport protein.
Right.
And that was, and the example that I gave for that was like, all right, if you had 200 people in our classroom and the door was shut, you know, air would obviously diffuse out of the classroom. It would go through the cracks of the walls and the windows and the door. But the humans couldn't because the door shut, right? But if you were to open the door, people would naturally leave that room because there's a lot of people in there. It would naturally diffuse out. But you would need someone to open that door, and that doorway would be the transport protein, so to speak. That would be the facilitated diffusion. And also, while we're on this subject, and I have this graphic up, technically, again, diffusion is a subcategory of passive transport. Facilitated diffusion is obviously a subcategory of diffusion. And also osmosis is a subcategory of diffusion because technically that is still diffusion. It's just a very specific example.
Water.
Yeah, exactly. Water over a semipermeable membrane. So great question because that allowed me to.
Passive transport is basically just anything that doesn't require an input of energy from the cell.
Passive? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And that brings me to osmosis. So there was quite a few questions, or I think there was more than one at least, where it was like, water and solute, and you're trying to see where the water will go or where the solute will go, especially with a balloon sunk in something.
Yes.
So water basically, if it has the ability to do so, wants to go to where the concentration of water is lower. So like if there's a bunch of solute in one side and less in the other, water is going to want to go to the side with more solute because there's less water on that side.
Exactly. Yes. Okay. Because
making sure I have that right.
Exactly. And it is still It is diffusion because it is water going from an area of higher water concentration to higher, to lower water concentration. The only part that gets it, most people get confused about, is the fact that you're dealing with beakers now, or not, excuse me, I'm thinking about beakers. You're dealing with solutes, and that changes the discussion, right? So if you have two beakers, and also I recommend this for anybody taking the exam. If you have scrap paper, I would keep it with you, especially if you've already done the study guides, you know what I'm talking about. There are a few questions like this, and to me, it helps to draw it out. So first of all the questions are going to be worded the same, have some similar wording as they do in the study guides, where it'll say something like, the balloon is permeable to water and not permeable to glucose, or something like that. I have to put that to make the question technically correct, but you can just assume for all those questions that if I'm talking about a balloon and a beaker, that the balloon, water can come in and out, but anything else can't. Glucose or whatever solute I talk about cannot come in or out of the balloon. So if you want to save time and just skip that part of when you're reading the question, that's fine, because again, I'm not going to try to trick you. That would be a good trick question though, if I said that the balloon was permeable to glucose and water. But anyway, so yeah, I would recommend drawing these things out. So if you have a question that says something like, you know, one balloon has 20% solute and the other balloon has, I don't know, 5% solute, and they're both in a beaker that has 10% solute. Right, that questions I could ask about this, but what I would do is draw it out and then figure out what would happen. So I know here, you know, it's a higher concentration of solute in here, and nature just wants to even things out. So what's going to happen is water is going to leave the beaker and go into the balloon, right? Or if this right. was a cell, because a balloon is just like a model for a cell. If it was a cell, same thing. Water would go in there, and while that's happening, you know, this number 10 would go up, right? Because as water is leaving the beaker, then the concentrate, it'll get more concentrated. So that number would go to 11 and then 12, so on and so forth. As water is leaving the beaker, that number would go up. And as water is entering the balloon, that water would go down, right? So that would keep happening until maybe it met in the middle, right? Until, like this said, 15%, that would be 15%. And then the opposite would happen here. Here, it's higher concentration outside. So water would leave the balloon and go into the beaker. So from these two beakers, if I were just give you this information about these two beakers, I could ask all kinds of questions like, which beaker or which balloon would be larger at the end of this, at the end of 30 minutes or whatever? And, you know, A would be larger, right? Because water is going in. Or I could say, which balloon would be smaller at the end of an hour or however much time? And you would say, oh, it would be balloon B because water is leaving. Or you might get some long winded question that gives you all this information, and then it might simply ask you which one has a balloon that is hypertonic. Whoops, wow, a little bit of dyslexia there. Hypertonic. Which one has a balloon that's hypertonic? And you might say, oh yeah, well that one's this. A has the balloon that's hypertonic. Or I might say, which one has a balloon that is hypotonic? And obviously this is the one that has the balloon that's hypotonic. Or I could ask again, after giving you all this information, I could say, which one has the beaker that is hypertonic, in which case it would be B. Or I could say, which one has the beaker that is hypotonic, in which case it would be A. So again, when you get a question like this, my recommendation is to draw it out, draw the situation out, and then read the question and see what it's asking. Because there's so many questions I could ask just off of this one little setup right here. So does all that make sense?
Yes. Yes, it does. Thank you.
Good. All right. I'll black out of that. All right. Stop sharing. All right. What's your next question?
It was number 24 on the 6 and 7 study guide. It's in photosynthesis, which molecule is produced when the above molecule provides electrons? And the answer to the above one's H2O. So you could put oxygen or NADPH. Well, good. I guess NADPH isn't really produced, but it does. It was something different, and now it has the electron, so it's called something different.
Yeah, let me pull it up. I'm glad you mentioned that because I just graded one of your classmates' study guides, and they were given the answer that I wasn't picturing in my brain when I wrote the question, but it was technically correct. So yeah, let me bring that up. Where are we at here? Classwork, chapter 6 and 7, study guide. All right, let me share my screen again. All right, so you can see the study guide, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So it says started on 24, right? All right, let's actually start right here. 23. Yeah, that would probably make more sense. Yeah. So in photosynthesis, which molecules provide electrons for the above? Oh, I guess I should back up. Here we go. Okay. Number 22. We'll back up one more. In photosynthesis, which stage uses photons to excite electrons? And we do know that that's obviously the light reactions, right? Because photons is light. So light reactions are, they're exciting electrons. But those electrons have to come from somewhere. And that's what question 23 is basically asking. Where do those electrons come from? And they come from water.
Water, yeah.
Yep. And when water gives up those electrons, which is what question 24 is asking, then that produces
oxygen.
Oxygen, yeah.
But I think I put NADPH because that's where my brain went the first time I did the study guide. Right. I was looking back through it today to see what questions I had. I was like, I think he's looking for oxygen, not.
Yeah. And for the study guide, you'll get that correct. And for the exam, I'm really, really, I'm almost positive now. I'm going to do multiple choice.
Right. And it doesn't matter as much since you're doing multiple choice.
Exactly. Because that won't be an option. Yeah. So that's another reason I'm strongly, I'm definitely going to stick with multiple choice because then that, you know, you won't, because that would be correct. You're right. Eventually those electrons do go to the, you know, to the electrons acceptors. So I'll eliminate that that option. Also, on that note, let's look at this. Provides energy, electrons, respiration. Okay. All right. In respirations, which stage or stages uses NADH to strip away high energy electrons? So that's the first two, right? Glycolysis and citric acid cycle. The whole purpose of those two is to strip away high energy electrons. So 14 is pretty straightforward. That's the answer to that. It's the first two. So then the question is, well, this is it's still pretty straightforward, but which molecule provides those high energy electrons? And the answer is glucose. It's ultimately glucose. Right. Now, if you were to argue it, you could say, well, yes, at first we get it from the glucose, but then we have pyruvate. We break that down to acetic acid, and then we break that down. So you could list all these different molecules that are providing we're stripping away high energy electrons. But again, with the multiple choice, the answer is going to be glucose because that's ultimately where they started.
Right. All the pyruvate and stuff came from the glucose anyway, didn't it?
Exactly. And then the acetic acid came from the pyruvate, so on and so forth. Yeah. But so we'll remove that ambiguity for the exam. Same thing with number 16. Which molecule accepts those high energy electrons? The answer I was going for when I wrote that question was the oxygen, right? Electrons eventually have to go somewhere. Where do they go? They go to the oxygen. But your classmate correctly put NAD plus, right? NAD plus, right. Like, yeah, I'll take some electrons.
I think so I did.
Well. Correct. Yeah, so again, for the exam, the correct answer for that question will be oxygen. For the study guide, if someone's already made the mistake, or it's not even a mistake, but for the study guide, if someone wrote NAD plus, that will be correct. Likewise, for number 17, once that molecule accepts the electrons, it turns into what? Now, if you're thinking what I was thinking, which is oxygen accepts it, then it becomes water. But again, what the other person wrote correctly was that if it was NAD plus, then it accepts the electrons and becomes NADH. So I'm glad you asked that. I was going to bring that up anyway. So for the exam, that'll be less confusing because you won't have these other correct options, but not the options that I was looking for.
Okay.
All right. Any other questions?
When a person cries, is that exocytosis?
Yes. If I remember correctly, the way the question was written is like things leaving, right? It's obviously right. Stuff coming out. Yeah. But that won't be on the exam either. Anything about endocytosis or exocytosis won't be on the exam, I don't think, unless I run out of questions, and I don't think that's going to happen. And anything else?
I think that's all the questions I had.
All right, that's nice and easy. I guess for anybody who's watching this video, And I've also answered an email recently, like before this. This is the official study exam review that we just completed. But if anyone needs help, I'm here to help. I can't guarantee I'll be available, but you just email me. If you want to meet online, like I'm doing right now, and get some help one-on-one, I will be there if I can. Just tell me what time you want to meet, and I'll try my best, especially if I can record it. It would be great to have multiple recordings of multiple exam reviews. So for anybody watching the video, just let me know. And like I said, shoot me the email. Same thing, Cooper, go ahead and shoot me the email, just because that way I'll have a paper trail, and so I don't forget. All right, well, that was easy. I'm going to stop recording, and I guess you just have a good day, and I will see you on Wednesday.
All right, you too. Thank you for answering my questions.
Not a problem.